The GymBro. GymBros have gone from being the butt of every single internet joke.
Oh, hold on, what's wrong with that?
To transforming into an entire movement spanning self-help, politics, philosophy, science, and completely changing the world.
Motivation is a feeling that comes and goes. Discipline is infinitely more important.
Get a sweat going, then you're gonna feel pumped.
Come on. I can't afford to have days wasting away feeling sorry for myself.
However, it hasn't been without its controversies.
It takes steroids because I reached a point where I felt like I couldn't get any bigger or stronger.
Quote, physical fitness has always been central to the far right.
That getting shredded will give you access to some elusive male dominance.
So let's start with a simple question. What is a GymBro? Found in every single gym across the world will be an unbelievably muscly man in a loose vest, wearing a snapback, holding onto a protein shake, who will communicate with other GymBros in what I like to call gym speak. Words such as swole, gained, shredded, bruh. While staring longingly at their incredible physiques in the mirror, this first wave of the GymBro was slightly vain, slightly obnoxious, and slightly dumb.
8 o'clock in the morning, I'll have fish and a rice cake. At 10 o'clock, I'll have fish. At 12 o'clock, I'll have fish and a rice cake.
But where did this stereotype come from? All the way back in 1977, there was a documentary called Pumping Iron. And this documentary followed the lives of bodybuilders, notably Arnold Schwarzenegger. In this documentary, we'd see the dedication, the discipline, but also their slightly simple brains.
And she's gonna fix a nice spaghetti, meatballs, cheesecake, apfelstrudel, the whole business.
Arnold's slightly broken English would often lead to very funny moments.
And that's what we call the pump. It's as satisfying to me as coming is. I mean, it's terrific, right?
A stereotype for bodybuilders emerged, which people referred to as meatheads.
I am hearing you, but you're not listening to me.
Your arms are bigger than your leg, bro.
And your brain's obviously not.
From the Hulk to Johnny Bravo, endless TV shows and films produce characters that would exaggerate this meathead stereotype, painting the impression that all bodybuilders only cared about getting muscly and were all pretty stupid.
Come on, guys, bring a few more. All we need is
Johnny Bravo. You are.
As we entered the digital age, so too did bodybuilders. When they weren't in the gym, you could find them online discussing and debating what piece of salmon they should eat at what hour and exactly how many chews you needed to maximize your jaw gains. But it would be one post on the 16th of February 2002 where a user by the name of Chris C responded to a fella by the name of Bubba T, where he asked, "Do you have any friends in real life? Do you even lift?" Do You Even Lift became a massive online meme. It was everywhere throughout the 2000s into the 2010s. And it would be accompanied by other GymBro-esque memes. Words like swole, clowning on people for skipping leg day. So the GymBro was basically a reskinned version of the meathead, updated for the internet age. However, on top of all of these jokes, stereotypes, and memes, there was a darker side to the GymBro culture. I'm super excited to have Tiege Hanley as today's video sponsor. A lot of us blokes don't really think about our skin, but Tiege Hanley helps men start and maintain a skincare routine by simplifying the whole process, basically making it idiot-proof. Honestly, it's the best skincare routine for guys like you and me. If you're a newbie like me, I recommend that you start with the level one, which comes with all your basics. So you've got your daily wash here. This just gets rid of all the dirt and grime off your face. You've then got an exfoliating scrub that you use 2 times a week. This just gets rid of all the dead skin cells. You got your AM moisturizer to put on in the morning. It has SPF 20 in it to protect you from that big old burner in the sky. You then got the PM moisturizer that you can use before you go to bed. It'll just keep your skin hydrated and healthy whilst you sleep. My personal favorite thing about Tiege Hanley is it comes with an instructional card. Because I have no idea about skincare, this is pretty helpful. It tells you a little bit about each product, how much to use, when to use it, and in what order. And it really just makes the process of having good skin really easy. Their products have genuinely made my skin look and feel much healthier. But I mean, don't just take my word for it. They have over 7,000 five-star reviews on their website. And on top of amazing skin, members of Tiege Hanley get tons of benefits, including at least 20% off retail price, the ability to customize your own box, exclusive monthly deals, you can pause or cancel at any time, and there's free US shipping as well as low cost shipping to other parts of the world. And because Tiege Hanley is sponsoring today's video, they're exclusively offering you guys a fantastic deal. Just click the first link in the description and you'll get 30% off your first box plus a free gift. So don't miss out on this amazing deal. Click the link and get started today. Anyway, back to the video.
I was engaged. A big reason why that came to an end was because of my steroid use.
There was this very dark side when it come to the side effects of steroid abuse. Things like liver damage, heart problems, hormonal imbalances. There'd be these major news stories of like roid rage. We'd see it with Chris Benoit and his double murder suicide. And the internet only made things get more and more extreme. Enter Zyzz.
Every one of us has a little bit of Zyzz in us. You just don't know yet.
Zyzz was an early internet legend who would go on to spawn a brand new wave of GymBro culture. And it's because there was something interesting about Zyzz. He would start out his journey as a typical 2000s internet virgin. Addicted to World of Warcraft, petrified of speaking to women.
I'm Josh.
Hi.
And having absolutely no self-confidence. However, in just a few years, he turned himself into this chiseled Adonis, with women flocking all over him and this cartoonish self-confidence. This right here was an evolution to the original meathead. The OG meathead was always seen as the natural jock alpha type, but Zyzz was different. He would deliberately act like this very overconfident GymBro type, using all the vocabulary, come at me bro, you mad, you might. He would relentlessly troll people who weren't as genetically gifted as he was, describing his own religion as shredology. But behind all of the memes and the trolling, Zyzz was doing something important. He had inspired these nerdy kids who didn't really have a lot of confidence to get in the gym, get bigger, and gain some self-discipline and self-confidence.
A well-known Sydney bodybuilder has died after collapsing in a sauna in Thailand. Doctors say the 23-year-old had an undiagnosed heart condition, but some say a growing obsession with body image is dangerous.
Since 2010, with the inception of Instagram, steroid use has risen year after year. The pressures put onto people inside the fitness community to take steroids has got worse and worse as well.
My income is based off of how I look, because the better I look, the better reach that I have, because the more the platforms push you, because it literally it's truth.
You see it with Alex Eubank, who is known for being a natural, saying that he is sometimes tempted and feels pressured to do it himself, despite literally looking like this. And so more and more stories about steroid abuse and the horrors that come with it would start going viral. You'd see them on videos from Derek of More Plates, More Dates. Something needed to change.
What are the health risks that guys should consider if they're thinking about going on TRTs?
Well, it depends the context in
and
which
so,
they enter.
Into the 2010s, a new wave of GymBro was emerging. After having developed their warrior bodies, the GymBros realized once they reached the peak of the mountain, it was just the first hill. There were more gains to be had, mental gains.
You get one. It doesn't make you dumber if you work out. Stop. I know that jocks were assholes and people bullied you. I get it.
Yeah.
But goddamn it, take care of your fucking meat vehicle.
Steps Joe Rogan. He was able to break the mold of the stereotypical GymBro. With his podcast that goes through many of his different interests, from MMA to fitness to science to anything, he showed that GymBros didn't just have to be one-track minded on their bodies. His podcast would explore these deep topics. It would explore self-improvement, how to live better, how to be healthier, how to develop a stronger mindset, be successful, and all around live a better, happier, more fulfilling life.
We have been fed this line of horseshit that you're supposed to seek comfort. And I don't think you are. I think you're supposed to seek lessons, and you're supposed to seek difficult tasks and—
In just like a minute and a half, I was freezing.
Ugh. And slowly a new wave of GymBro-esque content creators would come along, who would talk about the gym and lifting weights, but also would focus on self-improvement. This would get the kind of tongue-in-cheek name of bro science or bro philosophy. You'd have people like Chris Williamson and his podcast Modern Wisdom, Alex Hormozy, Andrew Huberman, Mike Thurston, Hamza, Cole Hastings. These creators would talk more than just about fitness and bodybuilding, but would venture into topics like business, increasing your product activity, various different health practices, sleep and diet, ice plunges, sauna, and ultimately how to be happy and manage the stresses of life while staying true to the GymBro roots, with the backing of this discipline being the gym.
And maybe I can build my value by improving myself.
All of these predetermined beliefs that you have in your mind start to challenge
yourself,
them.
The fact that you hold yourself to high standards and you care about things like telling the truth or finding agency.
These newer gym bros come across more as like a father or an older brother figure, as opposed to the gym frat boy party stereotype. And they would often make their content aimed at young men who are trying to figure out the world.
Is there something else going on about men's roles, do you think? Like young guys' roles? In the world?
Taking on the very heated and sometimes controversial topic of masculinity in the modern age, to a pretty mixed response from society.
And welcome to the Hard Man Good Times Brocast. My name is Butch Dieselsteak, and today we're going to be talking about self-improvement for young men.
There's a lot of talk, of writing, of research these days that says there's a crisis in masculinity.
Critics of the GymBro movement would often try and link it to Red Pill and Manosphere communities, who have seemed to have found their footing on YouTube making this very adversarial men versus women type of content.
Videos on why you should never get back with your ex, female nature, pickup artists, and masculine frame, you just can't stop watching these Red Pill videos.
And there is some crossover, but in reality, most of these GymBro gym philosophy types were really just successful men trying to give advice to other men. But it seemed any association with the masculinity conversation would often just all be lumped together by its critics.
Man, that's the problem with manosphere, is that there's grifters in the manosphere that aren't actual real men.
Yes.
And by real men, I mean they don't have resolve. If you took them on a hike, they would get tired. You would have to leave them behind.
On the 6th of December 2020, there was a viral tweet by a Twitter user called Flossy Baby J, where they said, "Why do men start podcasts instead of going to therapy?" I was listening to a podcast by Chris Williamson who featured this guy called Adam Lane Smith, who's a licensed psychotherapist, and they were talking about the ways that men and women respond differently to therapy.
Therapy models focus on helping men feel heard and loved instead of restoring their sense of personal power. Men need solutions, not just feelings.
Depending on where you are in the world, men can be from 2.5 up to as much as 4 times more likely to take their own lives than women. But women are nearly 2 times more likely to attend therapy. Often the argument is made that the reason men don't go to therapy is because of social stigma and things like that. But this podcast was trying to address the fact that women and men deal with problems differently.
The brain scans show us that the male brain goes backwards to observe and then forwards to act upon it. When we see a problem, we act upon that problem. That's how the male brain tends to work. The female brain tends to observe in the back and then go back and forth across the hemispheres and make a bunch of connections and process it. That is often why women communicate, to process with each other, to share with each other, and they need to feel heard.
But you see, 70% of therapists are women. So there's a potential that there is more of a slant towards therapy that works better for the feminine mind.
When you have a therapy model that just makes men feel heard and loved, okay, they kind of feel heard, I feel heard. And they kind of feel loved, well, I kind of feel loved. Now I feel like a useless piece of helpless garbage that other people are sitting here loving. That means they just pity me, and I am just an endless creature of pity who will never solve any problems. It almost makes them worse.
And so is it surprising that in this time there are endless podcasts that have popped up offering more practical advice and solutions?
Going from sauna to cold, 20 and 3, mm-hmm. 3 rounds.
I fast pretty much every day.
Like, are you doing 16 hours?
I would say getting to bed, ideally no later than like 11 or 12.
But this presents a problem. When you have endless, desperate young men looking for advice on life's issues, and they feel rejected by the mainstream,
the Me Too movement against sexual harassment.
Masculinity.
Men are replaceable.
Wait till men realize they're completely useless.
It opens the door for grifters that prey on vulnerable people, acting like they have all the answers to life, but actually offering really bad, more damaging advice to them.
So one of the standard advice that all these YouTubers will suggest is, okay, get in the gym and make some money. But they don't say that because it's gonna give you a more fulfilling, happy life. They always market it in a way that, yeah, and then you'll get back at the hoes who hurt you.
And so in this culture where you're seeing TikTokers shaming men in the gym for even looking in the same direction as a woman.
Woo! Oh, good form. Ah. That does not look good.
Vice then writing articles that gym bros are more likely to be right-wing assholes, and the activist group Hope Not Hate linking the fitness subculture into far-right extremism. It feeds into this alienation as opposed to trying to understand them and actually help them.
I don't think there's enough people saying man up.
Yeah, and I don't mean ignore your emotions. I mean fucking integrate your emotions. Yeah. Talk about them. Manning up also includes being mature about your emotions. This is me saying fucking transcend and include your masculinity.
I would argue that the by and large majority of this community have actually become a far more enlightened gym bro. They're able to teach men to be strong and courageous, but also compassionate and caring. To be more disciplined against their addictions and short-term gratification. To delve deeper into their psychological shortcomings and address those things. And become a loving role model to the people around them. So with that, I have one final thing to say, and that is, do you even lift, bro? If you enjoyed this video, be sure to leave a like and subscribe to the channel, and watch this video right here.